this ready yet, but some of those that have been coming to couples retreat, I mean couples Bible study, they're wanting to do a retreat in February, and we're opening it up to everyone, not just the ones that are at the Bible study, because, I mean, as we can testify from this weekend, getting together and fellowshipping together and just immersing yourself in God helps greatly.
Amen.
Opens up your heart, opens up your vision and your purpose. And I think we have 10 couples that have been pretty much consistently attending. But we even have a couple guys, Johnny and Jesse, who are coming and studying with us. So don't think you have to be married to come or even have a date. It's okay. Most of the cabins have bunk beds too. So, but I need to know how many. So I'm trying to get a count by probably mid-December. If in a couple weeks I'll look at the list and I'll go off that to try to find us a cabin somewhere to go to. Okay?
Amen.
All right. It'll be back here hanging on the wall.
Amen. Turn, if you would, to the book of Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 12. We're going to continue in our study on the gifts of the Spirit. But before you do that, or what, just hold your place there, turn over to Deuteronomy chapter 31 real quick. Deuteronomy chapter 31. And I want to read to you verse 7. Actually, we'll read verse 6 and 7. Deuteronomy 31. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. I was up on the mountain, literally, last week, and just praying and seeking God. And the Lord began to just show me some things, and just in my own life personally. And I want to share something with you that I think is a word for somebody today. I don't know who, but I believe it's a word for you. Hopefully all of us. Deuteronomy, let me just give you the background real quick. The Lord is speaking to Joshua, and they are about to go into the promised land. And in the promised land, and listen, let me tell y'all something. A lot of times you'll hear old spirituals, or you'll hear a lot of songs that talk about we're going to the promised land, and the promised land representing heaven. Biblically, the promised land does not represent heaven. There's no enemies in heaven. There's no walled cities in heaven. There's no giants in heaven. There's no adversaries and warfare in heaven. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
But the promised land does represent, in this life here, where God wants to take you in your life, that in that journey, in the promised land, through the promised land, and to the promised land. You can't do it without Him, but it is a land that God has promised that you and I need to enter into and need to battle through, listen, and take possession of what God has given you as your promised land in your life. Are you hearing me? And so look what God says, and this is what I want to emphasize on, and then we'll get to our message. So God tells, through Moses, Joshua, be strong and of good courage. Do not fear nor be afraid of them. Talking about the giants. For the Lord your God, He is the one who goes with you. Say, God is with me. Now watch this. He will not leave you, and He will not forsake you. He will not leave you. He will not forsake you. You are not alone. You might feel alone. You might think you're alone. And the devil might say, where is your God? He has not left you. He will not leave you. And He is right with you. Amen?
Amen.
Now look at verse 7. Then Moses called Joshua. Now he's talking to the children of Israel in verse 6. Now he specifically talks to Joshua. Then Moses called Joshua and said to him in the sight of all Israel, be strong and of good courage, for you must go with this people to the land which the Lord has sworn to your fathers to give them and you, and shall cause, say shall cause. Now who's going to do that? God is. Who's going to cause this to happen? God is. Now listen, you cannot manipulate enough people, enough circumstances, enough things. You can't have enough money or the lack thereof to bring all into fruition and fulfillment what God wants for you in your life and where God wants to take you. God causes that to happen.
Amen.
Do you hear me? God causes that to happen. How does God cause that to happen? By you and I being strong and of good courage and just surrendering to Him. Submitting to Him. And then watch this. He shall cause them to inherit it. And the Lord, He is the one who goes before you. Listen, guys. I want you to know something. I don't know your life personally at home and at work and as a mom or a dad and a husband and a wife or a single person or apart from here. I have no idea. But I know this. There is not one of you sitting in here this morning for whom God does not have a promised land, destiny, and what is the word I'm hunting for? Promise for your life. It's bigger than you, and it has giants in it. But you and I have to literally, spiritually pull ourselves up in the name of Jesus by our spiritual bootstraps. Say, Lord, we will not be defeated. We will not be discouraged. Satan, you will not rob me of what God has promised me in His Word. You will not rob me, and all of your giants will not rob me of the destiny that I was born to fulfill for Jesus. You will not rob me of the calling God has put on my life. You cannot have my wife. You cannot have my kids. You cannot have my destiny. No matter how big the giant is, no matter how numerous the giants may be, no matter how fortified they may seem, and no matter how loud they may sound, God is bigger, God is better, God is stronger, and God has already gone before you. They're already defeated in Jesus' name. And you and I have to move in the territory that He has already taken for you at the cross in Jesus. And now it is for you and I to move into that. So you move your own life personally into that. You move your marriage into it, your family into it, your business into it. You move your health into it. You do it intentionally. You do it purposely. Are you tracking with me? It's not going to happen by accident. He told Joshua, be of good courage. Don't be afraid. You and I have to make a choice in Jesus to move in to what God's called you into. Or we can just flutter like a leaf in the wind, falling out of a tree, and just land wherever we may land. I don't want to live like that, amen? God's already gone ahead of you. Take the challenge in Jesus. And say, Lord, I don't want to be a 70% God's will person. I want to live sold out 100% in the name of Jesus, serving you. And guys, when we do that, it'll never be easy, but it'll always be an adventure. And it will always result in you being the most joyous and fulfilled you will ever be in your life this side of heaven. So anyway, I wanted to share that with you. Turn over, if you would, to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and let's get right in the Word for today. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. We've been doing a series on the Holy Spirit and then spiritual gifts, and you can get on Facebook and look up Spencerville Church and get all of the messages prior to this. So we went through week before last the word of knowledge and the word of wisdom, or vice versa, the word of wisdom and then the word of knowledge. And we looked at in 2 Chronicles the story of Judah and Jehoshaphat, the king, in specifically, and how God used the word of wisdom and the word of knowledge in their life. And we're not going to take time to go through all this, so go back and look at that. But there were some things I do want to share with you real quick. If you weren't here, you can just jot these down. Some of the things that we learned was, number one, when we are confronted with giants or armies or contrary circumstances or things that make you say, wow, I didn't see that coming, we need to seek, fast, and then ask. And that was in 2 Chronicles 20, verse 3. Verse 7, we need to remember what God has done in the past. Don't doubt in the darkness what God has clearly shown you in the light. Amen?
Amen.
Verse 12, total surrender. Verse 13, wait on the Lord. Verse 14 and 15, a word of wisdom. Verse 16 and 17, a word of knowledge. Then verse 18, worship the Lord. Then verse 19, follow God's word obediently, not veering to the right or the left. God gives wisdom to all who will ask in faith and total surrender, James 1, 5 through 8. So, what is a word of knowledge? It is a supernatural revelation of information and or instruction pertaining to a person or an event given for a specific purpose, usually having to do with an immediate need. The word of knowledge might be understood as the ability to proclaim God's revelation or of information and or instruction to those who need to hear it, or to offer understanding on how it applies to a specific area of life. Then the next gift that we see is found here in verse 9. So let's read this. Look in verse 1. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brothers, I don't want you to be ignorant. You know that you were Gentiles carried away to these dumb idols, however you were led. Therefore, I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed, and no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. There are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are differences of ministries, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of activities, but it is the same God who works all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of who? All. For the profit of all. There's no super saints. There's no super Christians. Every gift is given for each of us to work hand in hand with one another. Someone being a hand, someone being a foot, someone being an eye, someone being an ear. But all working in uniformity and in order and in balance for the betterment of the whole body. And then when all are blessed, we're individually blessed. So then he says this here in verse 8. For to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit. To another the word of knowledge through the same Spirit. And then for today, our message today, to another faith by the same Spirit. And then to another, gifts of healings by the same Spirit. Now we'll see why these are put together in just a minute. Let me just bring this out real quick so I don't forget it. Notice he says gifts, plural, of healings, plural. Now we'll talk about this in just a minute, but how many of you know there's numerous diseases, amen? There's numerous sicknesses, plural. But Sometimes we limit God and put God in a box and restrict God by restricting God to healing only diseases and only sicknesses and only infirmities that are bacterial or viral or cancerous related. How many of you know that God wants to heal your mind? How many of you know God can and wants to heal your emotions? How many of you know God wants to heal you of depression and anxiety? How many of you know that God wants to heal you of a runaway brain? See, He does not just want to heal and be restricted in the area of it's a disease. It's a heart issue, or it's a lung issue, or a gut or digestive problem, or it's some disease. No, He wants to heal you and I and make us whole. As 1 Thessalonians 5 says, in spirit, body, and soul. Spirit, body, and soul. He wants you to be healed. Now let me tell you something else. Let me take it further. How many of you know God wants to heal your marriage? How many of you know, listen to me, how many of you know God wants to heal your relationships? How many of you know God wants to do a healing in your heart toward the church? And then above all things, say amen. Amen. How many of you know God wants to do a healing in you and how you see Him? Amen. And how you hear from Him. And how you think about Him. How many of you know He wants to do a work in you and a work in me and healing that gives you and I the right perspective and the right understanding of who He is and how He wants to work in your life. So Paul uses the plural gifts and the plural healings because that's what he's wanting to do in you and I. Not just fix your body, but he wants to fix the you that lives in this body. And heal you of scars that aren't scars that are seen on the skin. And heal you of scars that aren't seen on the cut on the face. Are you tracking with me?
Amen.
And heal you of scars that nobody else even knows where you have scars. Secret scars. Undercover scars. Scars in the closet that you never brought out. You see, God being the ultimate physician in Jesus that He is, He sees all these scars and what caused those scars to be scars. He sees the hurt that caused those scars, but the difference in Him and a normal doctor is a normal doctor just sees what's on the surface. Jesus sees what the cause and effect of what on the surface is. Amen. So what we need to do is, and we'll probably talk about this again next Sunday. I just feel it in my spirit. What has to happen is, I have to yield those hurts and yield those cuts and that I've tried to stitch up myself so nobody would see them. I'll get through this on my own. How's that working out for you? Yeah, exactly. It doesn't. Now listen, I want you to say this with me. Jesus wants me well. That's the truth in the Word of God. Jesus wants me well. Jesus wants my wife well. Jesus wants me well. Jesus wants my kids and my grandbabies well. Jesus wants you and your family well. But listen, not just physically in this physical body. Amen. He is trying to get through to you today. I want to heal the scars nobody can see. I want to heal you of what caused them.
Amen.
Somebody said amen.
Amen.
I'll say it for you, preacher. That's me.
That's me.
All right, I'm getting way ahead. Here we go. The gift of faith. Let's start there. Amen. All right. The gift of faith is a unique form of faith. Now we're talking about the gift of faith. And I'll talk about general faith in just a minute. We all have to have faith to get saved. Amen. So Paul says, and we'll talk about this in just a minute, we've all been given a portion of faith, salvation faith, by the Holy Spirit. It's a gift of grace and mercy that we cannot earn. And that faith, Ephesians 2, 8, 9, for by grace you are saved through faith, and that's not of yourselves. Salvation faith is not of yourselves. You can't work it up. You can't earn your way to it. You can't buy it, purchase it. None of these things. When you and I surrender to the conviction of the Holy Spirit, then the Holy Spirit, as a gift, gives us the faith to believe God and receive Jesus into our heart and life. But the faith that he's talking about here is the gift of faith that operates as a gift of the Holy Spirit in a person's life. And so that's what we're going to look at this morning. It goes beyond natural faith. It goes beyond saving faith. It supernaturally trusts and does not doubt with reference to the specific matter, person, place, or thing that is involved. By definition, every born-again believer has faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. By definition, every believer has faith to believe God's Word through the help of the Holy Spirit. The spiritual gift of faith that is listed here and is narrowly implied here seems to involve the ability to trust God with the confidence for certainty that is beyond the natural ability of the born-again believer. So if you looked in Acts chapter 11, when the Bible's talking about Barnabas in verse 24, it says he was full of the Holy Spirit and of faith. He had the gift of faith that operated through him. The Bible says of Stephen, he was full of the Holy Spirit and of faith. And so Luke specifically mentions the faith that he had, the gift of faith that was very obvious working in and above most of those around them. And they stood out in their ability to believe God. Listen, not only in lifestyle faith, we'll look at that, but in situational faith, we'll look at that. So the gift of faith operates in lifestyle faith, but it operates in situational faith as well. And situational faith would be when you're confronted, like I said earlier, with some of those things that come along that you're like, wow, I didn't see this coming. Or it's a faith for to help you stand with someone, drawing alongside someone, believing with someone where they're not having the faith to believe. Do you hear what I'm saying? And that's where you draw alongside them in faith. And you say, I'm going to walk with you through this. And God gives you a supernatural faith in order to step alongside, to bring them through by the power of the Holy Spirit, whatever it is situationally that is confronting them. Can I just say this? That's why we need each other. That's why we need each other. I may have something I'm really struggling with, and Eric may have to draw alongside me in faith and say, brother, I'm going to stand with you in this in the name of Jesus, and we're going to walk this out together. And he be very, very strong where I'm very, very weak. And God, through the Holy Spirit, give him the faith to believe God with me for what I'm trusting God to do in me, through me, and with me in that moment. But yet I'm struggling with doubt. I'm struggling with endurance. I'm struggling with temptation. I'm struggling with wanting to give up. I'm struggling with walking like I should be walking. And he comes alongside me with the gift of faith. And he says, I am going to walk with you, my brother. Or my sister, whichever might be applicable. We need each other. Excuse me. So let's look at lifestyle faith. Lifestyle faith. Look in Hebrews chapter 11. Turn over there real quick if you would please. Hebrews chapter 11. This is the gift of faith operating in the lifestyle like it did in Barnabas, like it did in Stephen, like it should be in you and I. And hey, I said this a while back, it needs clarification today. Each gift is not just particular to one individual person. By that I mean, you might be in a circumstantial situation where you need the gift of prophecy, amen? But you may not walk in that gift every day. But you're with someone who desperately needs a word from God. And so at that moment, you don't, as I said before, you don't run to Nina and say, Nina, I need you to come and this person needs a word. No, Nina's 400 miles away. God wants to use you in that gift to share a word with this person. Do you hear me? Same way with the gift of faith. Same way with the gift of healings. You might have somebody say, man, we need to call the preacher. He has the gift of healing. And no. You anoint them and pray over them. I might be in Colorado like I was last week. Now, if there is the ability for you to call the elders of the church to come and anoint you and pray over you with oil, that's biblical and we should. But you're not always where you can do that. You might be down next to the river and somebody's bleeding out and they need an immediate miracle. Amen? So God can use you. And He can work this gift of healing through you. If you'll believe Him and trust Him and allow Him to. All right, so here we go. Lifestyle faith. Look at verse 23. We want to talk about Moses here for a minute. By faith, Moses, when he was born, was hidden 3 months by his parents because they saw he was a beautiful child. Now watch this. And they were not afraid of the king's command. God gave them a faith to believe that God would take care of this child because they knew this child was special to God. Listen, same with your child, same with your grandkid. And they had the faith to believe God to take care of this baby and do in this baby with Moses what normal, natural human ability could not accomplish. That's what you and I have to do with our kids. They may not know it. They might be at the age they think they know everything. And they don't want to receive from you. But that's irrelevant because Moses was a baby and couldn't even talk yet. Are you hearing me? But yet God, because of the authority He had placed in the parents over that child, they used that authority and believed God and walked in that authority and prayed in that authority, and they were not afraid what would happen to them because God, and through the Holy Spirit, had given them the faith to believe. I don't care what Pharaoh said. We're going to keep this baby. We're not going to give this baby up for death. And we are going to believe that God has got a call on this baby's life. And He did. And then it says, verse 24, by faith, Moses, when he became of age, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God rather than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin. He esteemed the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he looked to the reward. And that just simply means he looked to the time when he would be with Jesus for all eternity. And it gave him strength. Moses lived a lifestyle of faith. And it was a faith that God had gifted him. Now listen to me. A lot of people say, well, that's Moses. That's not me. I'm not like Moses. I didn't part the Red Sea, or God through me didn't part the Red Sea. He didn't deliver people through me out of Egypt and all this and that. The same God that was the God of Moses is the same God through Jesus who is the God of you.
Amen.
Who is your Father. You remember in the book of James in chapter 5 where James is talking about healing and he talks about Elijah and he said how Elijah prayed that it wouldn't rain and it didn't rain for 3.5 years? That's faith. That was a gift of faith. And then he prayed that it would rain at God's command, and it did rain 3.5 years later. And then he says these words that we oftentimes just read over and don't take into account. He said this, Elijah was a man of like passions as we are. In other words, he's trying to get the point across, he was just as human as you, and the same God that was the God of Elijah is the same God who is the God over you. Listen, and that same God, this is the point, that same God has not changed.
Amen.
Guys, listen, God's not changed. The same God we're reading about here and whom you and I are to have faith in and believe in for our lives, who wants to heal you, who wants to who wants to resurrect in you life that he intends for you to have, who wants to heal your scars and the cause of those scars, who wants to get rid of depression, who wants to get rid of anxiety, who wants to restore your relationships, listen, and who wants you and I to walk daily in wholeness. In wholeness. That same God has not changed. His heart for you is the same as his heart for Matthew, Mark, John, Peter, Luke, and everybody else in the Word of God. So when you read about the woman with the issue of blood for 12 years who had spent all that she had in Mark chapter 5, when you read about her and she said, if I just but touch the hem of his garment, because knowing who he is Jesus, I'll be healed. And she had, by the power of the Holy Spirit, the faith to believe Jesus, to do in her, listen, what no doctors, no psychologists, no psychiatrists, no friends, no self-help book, no Dr. Spock or Dr. Phil, what nobody could do for her. She's at her wit's end. Y'all ever been there? She'd spent all she'd had. She had no more money to spend. But she understood and grasped by the power of God, she grasped the truth that Jesus, who created all of heaven and earth and all that you see, who is all powerful and everything is under her feet, including her condition and sickness, she knew that unchanging Jesus, Almighty God in the flesh, could fix her.
Amen.
Amen.
Where nobody else could. He could fix what was wrong with her. Listen to me. And the same love that Jesus had for her is the same love Jesus has for you.
Yes.
Now watch this. You got to get this. The same approachability that Jesus had for her to be able to approach him. And she knew she could approach him because if she got caught, she would be stoned because she was unclean. She had to stay outside the city. But she knew because of seeing Jesus, hearing Jesus, faith comes by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. She heard his word. She knew his heart. Watch. And because she knew the heart of Jesus, she knew Jesus would not reject her. You know why a lot of you don't come to Jesus and a lot of you watching on YouTube don't come to Jesus? Because you think it's pointless? Because yes, He loves me and yes, He's real, but He'll reject me and my offer. And the Bible says very clearly in Romans chapter 2, God is no respecter of persons. He doesn't love me any more than He loves Tony. He doesn't love me any more than He loves Spencer. He doesn't love me any more than He loves Ashley. I've said this a million times. You got to understand, He can't love you any more than He does.
Amen.
He loves you with all of God that He is. He doesn't love you in percentages. He loves you with all the godness that He is. He loves you as being fully God. And this woman with the issue of blood realized that, and she knew God could fix her. And guess what? God fixed her. My point in this Bible story is you are just the same as that woman when it comes to Jesus. He is approachable by you. He is attentive to you, and He wants to see you fixed.
Amen.
Listen, not just physically and in your body. He wants you to be made whole. He wants you to be made whole. Spirit, body, soul. But guys, He can't heal you if you won't approach Him. He can't heal you if I won't believe Him. He can't fix my broken heart, my cut in two heart, my been on the chopping block heart, my 50 relationships down the drain heart, my I can't trust nobody heart, my I'm depressed with anxiety heart. He can't fix all that if you and I won't come to Him and say, Jesus, I need you.
Amen.
And believe that He's approaching.
Yes.
Listen to me. And I'll close with this. We didn't cover anything we was going to cover.
Oh, you have no idea.
Listen.
Oh, yeah.
Listen, I'm going to tell you something. You got to hear me. Listen and say amen.
Amen.
Jesus does not love with a love that is a noun. Do you hear me? That means that it's immovable. It's just a word. Jesus loves with a love that is a verb. In other words, it's not enough for Jesus to just say, I love you, and have knowledge of what's going on in you or with you. But Jesus says in Matthew 11, come to me. That's step number one. Do you hear me? Step number one, come to me. And then He gives the invitation to who that's for. All. Tell me, Calvin.
All
of you who are heavy laden. Now listen, He did not get into specifics of what the heavy laden and burdens was, did He? Why? Because it doesn't matter. He is the answer to whatever's wrong with you.
Amen.
It doesn't matter what it is. That's why there's not a litany list of each individual thing. Why? Because it doesn't matter. Why? Because He can fix it all.
Amen.
He can fix it all. Listen to me. Wouldn't it be nice to have some stability in your life? Somebody said amen,
amen.
Not just me.
Amen.
That can only be found in Jesus. Now the question is this. The question is not can He? The question is not will He? The question is will you?
Amen.
Will you come to Jesus Number one, if you're here this morning and you've never been saved, you don't have a relationship with Jesus, you know about Jesus, but you don't know Jesus. Let me give you an example and I'll close. We'll use this next week in a lot more detail. But remember in Luke 17 when the 10 lepers came to Jesus and the Bible says they stood at a distance. Now they wanted to keep the law. They stood at a distance. And they cried out to Jesus. Jesus didn't wave his hand. He didn't make mud and put on them. He didn't tell them to go dip in the pool. None of these things. The Bible says he simply just spoke and said, go show yourself to the priest. That's all he said. He just thought it and they were healed. That's pretty powerful, isn't it?
Amen.
I mean, he just like, zip, they're healed. And by faith, they start toward the priest. Now watch this. But only one of the 10 returned. And the Bible says in Luke, and Luke records this, says, he fell at his feet. And he worshiped Jesus and called him Lord. Now watch. The other 9 recognized Jesus, but only the one received Jesus. You can recognize Jesus all you want, but it's a whole different ball game when you receive Jesus. Are you hearing me?
Amen.
And when he received Jesus, he was made whole. Now he'd already been healed. Physical. But now he's made whole mentally, emotionally, and above all, spiritually.
Amen.
He now has a relationship with Jesus as Lord and Savior. Now watch this. And the Bible says that Jesus marveled and said, were there not 9 others healed? Actually, he said, were there not 10 healed? Where are the other 9? Faith without thankfulness and gratitude does not result in wholeness. They had faith to believe that God would heal them, but they did not have faith to follow Jesus. No gratitude, no thankfulness, and it showed. A lot of people want to use Jesus as a step up to a different life than they have without receiving Jesus. They want to be healed, but they don't want to be made whole. It's a big difference in recognizing Jesus and receiving Jesus.
Amen.
So what I am talking to you and myself about this morning is, are you willing to receive, number one, Jesus himself? But if you're born again and belong to Jesus and your name's in the Lamb's Book of Life, hear me. Are you willing today to say, Jesus, I receive you, but I also receive what you have for me. I need to be made whole. I need some healing. I need some scar removal. I need some things done in me I can't do and all the doctors can't do and the 50,000 books and YouTube videos of counseling I've watched can't fix. Are you hearing me? He can. Guys, he's approachable. He's approachable and he loves you. And he has a plan for you. Preacher, you don't know how much water's under that bridge. Let me tell you, it don't matter. There is no sin in your life that his grace can't cover.
Amen.
If you'll repent and you'll turn to him. I don't care how much of it is or how big it is or how costly it's been. If you'll run to him, he'll take you with arms open wide and he'll restore you. Listen, not just physically, mentally, emotionally, and above all, spiritually, by giving you a personal relationship with Him that Satan himself and all of hell cannot take from you. Let's stand. Amen. Isn't God good? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Would you bow with me? God's so awesome. If you want to come pray, you come pray. We'd love to have you come pray. Altars are open, or we'll pray for you and pray with you. We would love to do that as well. Whatever God has put in your heart, you do. But here's what I want to challenge you first. If you'd say, "Preacher, I need Jesus today. I have not been saved. I do not know the Lord. I've never been born again. But I want to be born again today. I want to know Jesus today." So if you need to come, would you just come and say, "I want to be saved"? Anybody? Just raise your hand. I'm going to pray. Thank you. I'm going to pray for you. We're all going to pray with you. Anybody? I need to be saved. Anybody need to be saved today? Anybody? I see that, sweetheart. Anybody else? Anybody need to be saved today? I need Jesus. Back here? Okay. Amen. Thank you, baby. I see you, hon. I see you. Anybody else? Amen, brother. Thank you, Jesus. All right. Anybody else before we close? Anybody? I need to be saved. I need to be saved. Okay. Listen. If you raised your hand, I'm going to challenge you. Just step out where you're at and come up here with me. Anybody? Just come on. I'm proud of you, hon. Very proud of you. Proud of you, sis. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, buddy. Amen. Amen. God loves the children. Amen. 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 Come on, babies. Y'all are good. Come on. Thank you, Jesus. Okay, now before we pray for anything else, we're going to pray with these to be saved. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. All right, here we go. Let me ask y'all something. All right, you listen? Ready? Do you believe Jesus died on the cross for your sins? Do you believe He rose from the dead and He is alive? You believe Jesus is alive? And He is. You're right. He is. Do you believe that if you ask Him to save you, He will? Oh, Jesus. Woo! Yes, He will. Jesus. Yes, He will. So, we're going to pray with you. Amen. So here's what I want to do. I'm going to lead you. The whole church is going to pray with you. But I'm going to lead you in a prayer. But you make it your own prayer for Jesus. Amen. Amen. Woo, Jesus. All right, here we go. Say this out loud with me. Here we go. Church, dear Jesus, I need you. I believe you died on the cross for me. And you rose from the dead. Jesus, I believe if I ask, you will save me because you promised. And you keep your promises. Jesus, forgive me of all my sin and come into my heart and save me and make me yours. From this day, for all eternity, I give you my life. No strings attached. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. God's so awesome. All right, babies, listen. Listen, guys. Okay, what I want you to do now. Do y'all have a Bible? Do you have a Bible? Do you have a Bible? No? Well, you will have. You will have. So, I want you to get in the book of John in the New Testament and start reading. Get mama to help you, okay? Get mama to help you. And y'all sit down and read. And then I'm going to talk to you and your parents about being baptized, okay? Now, that doesn't save you, and it doesn't keep you saved, but it does show that we've been saved to the whole public, okay? So we'll talk more about that. All right, I love you very, very much. Jesus loves you. We love you. And I'm very, very proud of you. Okay, so what's your name? What, Serena? Serena? Sailor?
Yeah, that's her name.
Okay, what's your name?
Kylan.
Kylan?
Jeremy.
Jeremy?
Jacqueline.
And I knew Jacqueline.
Camden.
All right. Well, let me tell y'all something and before we go, and then we're going to pray over these other guys who has come down. Jesus wrote your name in the Lamb's Book of Life. So now, Jesus, your preacher's a ball bag. I can't help it. So now Jesus has written your name in the Lamb's Book of Life, and it'll never be erased. And He is your Father forever and ever and ever. And He is always with you. And the Holy Spirit has now moved in your heart. And He will live there from now on. So what you need to do, and I need to do, ask Him everything. Ask Him every question you can think. Talk to Him all day long. Pray. Praise Him. Tell Him how much you love Him. And He will speak to you. He will speak to your hearts. He has a voice. He will speak to you. And He'll speak to you also when you read your Bible, okay? All right. We're very, very proud of you. Very proud of you. And we love y'all. All right. All right, church. Let's pray. We've had some come down to pray for, y'all pray for healing. Is that right?
For healing for Rhema.
Healing for Rhema. Okay.
Been in the hospital a couple of times.
Really? Okay, so we want to pray over Rhema and Rhema, you're for Rhema. Okay, both of you for Rhema. All right, they're standing in for Rhema. God heals, amen.
Amen.
We just talked about that this morning. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Michael, would you come forward for something?
All right, here we go. And now, am I missing anybody? Anybody come forward for anything before we pray?
And don't forget Matt Deal.
Matt Deal, hey, Rick, where you at, brother? What's her name?
Paula Fitch.
Paula Fitch. Severely, Melvin. Severely with cancer. We need to pray for her.
Melvin.
All right, am I missing anybody else? Now listen, before we pray, Michael. Anybody else need to come and we'll pray over you? Anybody else? Everybody good?
Anoint Michael. He just ain't talking.
Michael? Son, we need to pray over you?
No.
Yeah, he does.
Okay. All right, well, here we go. All right, you ready? All right, thank you, Jesus. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we pray over Rhema. And Father, every other person that has been mentioned as well. Father, you have not changed. Your power has not. There's nothing to change. You are God. You are perfection defined. You are eternal. And Father, your love is the same. Father, according to your grace, your mercy, your power, and your pleasure, Father, we ask you to heal Rhema right now in the name of Jesus and these others as well. Satan, the Lord rebuke you in the name, the Lord Jesus Christ rebuke you. God, a ruler of all eternity, the King of kings, the Lord of lords, who under whose feet is everything. By His authority, the Lord Jesus Christ rebuke you and you leave them now. In Jesus' name, take your disease, your sickness, and all of your lies and deceit as well. In the name of Jesus, and be gone. And Father, in Jesus' name, I pray over this church. Father, we ask you to rebuke the spirit of depression. We ask you to rebuke the spirit of division. We ask you to rebuke the spirit of anxiety. Father, we ask you to rebuke the spirit of sickness and disease. Father, the spirit of divorce. Father, the spirit of relational issues. And Lord, we claim your unifying spirit, the Holy Spirit, in the name of Jesus. And Father, thank you for those that you have saved today. Thank you for the healing that you're doing today. And Father, thank you for the emotional healing.
Yes.
Father, the healing of scars that can't be seen.
Yes, Jesus.
And Lord, the healing that needs to take place in all of our lives.
Yes.
Father, we run to you.
Yes.
And we bow at your feet, Jesus. And we ask you to put your hands upon us.
Thank you, Jesus.
and heal us. That is your heart. Father, and we give you the praise, and we give you the glory, and we give you the honor. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and King and Savior, and the church said,
Amen.
Amen. Good to see you in the house of God. Hallelujah. You are dismissed. I'm so proud of you guys. Seriously. God is